So again, my name's Farron. I'm a physiotherapist in BC, and one of my primary areas of practice is in vestibular rehab. I've been working in this area for about the last 8 years, and I'm excited to be sharing this information with you. So the objectives of today's talk are primarily that we want to first talk to you a little bit about the anatomy and function of the vestibular system and how difficulties with that system could cause symptoms of vertigo, dizziness, and imbalance. Also going to talk about some of the specific symptoms and triggers of a vestibular dysfunction, and if and when those are something that could be treated with vestibular rehabilitation. And then finally, we're also going to discuss what vestibular rehab may actually look like for those people that are in the clinic. So what is vestibular therapy? So vestibular therapy is the assessment and treatment of dysfunction arising from the inner ear or the vestibular system. Now, these can often cause a multitude of symptoms. As an example would be vertigo, which is the sensation of movement. A lot of times these symptoms or these words get interchanged. So vertigo is really a symptom of movement. People often say a spinning type sensation, whereas dizziness is more of a vague term that could mean imbalance. It could mean that you're feeling kind of off center. You could feel a fuzziness or heaviness in your head. So we're often spending a lot of time in the clinic trying to decipher people's descriptions of how they're actually feeling. So you're dizzy. Why is that a big concern? You know, the main thing that we're concerned about is that even though about a third of people will experience a vestibular dysfunction in their lifetime, of which the main thing that we would see is a condition called BPPV, it increases the risk of falls. So dizziness is a common leads to falls and other secondary complications. In fact, some studies have placed it at a 12-time increase in falls when someone has a vestibular dysfunction. So that's a big concern, because we know that especially things like hip fractures in the elderly can be a source of long-term hospitalization and potential death if they're not able to restore their mobility. So there's obviously a big lifestyle cost to that, but also a cost to the overall system for those people that are in the hospital for a longer period of time. So if we look at the vestibular system itself, it's not a huge part of our body, but it's very, very important. So the vestibular system that we'll be talking about today is very small. It's about the size of a dime or the end of your pinky finger. And it's actually located and formed out of a number of grooves. They're part of the temporal bone of your skull. So if we zoom in on that, that's just behind the ear, the bone just behind the back of your ear. And if we zoom in closer to look at that system, we can see the anatomy more clearly. So the ear is actually made up of three basic areas. So highlighted in green here is the outer ear. So this is where sound would travel down the ear canal to the area of the eardrum. This red area here makes up a portion of the middle ear. And so this is where the small bones of the middle ear would transfer vibration from the eardrum to the inner ear. And then the innermost part of the ear is made up of two components. One, the vestibular system, which is what we're talking about today, as well as this snail-looking object, which is called the cochlea, which is the sensory organ for our hearing system. Now, the vestibular system itself has two functional areas. The first is a couple of pouches called the utricle and the saccule. And these areas contain sensory organs that respond to gravity. So as an example, this is what would allow you to feel yourself move up or down or forwards or backwards in relation to gravity. So if you think of going up and down in an elevator, you don't see yourself moving, but you can feel yourself moving up and down. The second area of the vestibular system is a series of tubes called our semicircular canals. And they are filled with fluid and they respond to our head movements. So when we move our head left or right, up or down, it sends a signal to our brain that we're doing those movements. So I've got a few pictures here just to better describe that movement. So this first picture is showing the cupula, which is the sensory organ of the semicircular canals. And when you move your head left or right, the fluid will push this little cupula, this little sense organ, one way or the other, and send a signal to the brain that you've moved your head. Whereas the utricle and the saccule, these are where these little crystals that everyone kind of hears about with the vestibular system live. So they are called otoliths. They're little calcium carbonate crystals. And they sit on top of a little jelly-like base called the otolithic membrane. So I like to think of it like fruit on top of jello, if we've ever had that dessert before. And when we move our head down or up, or in relation to gravity, move up or down, forwards or backwards, those crystals act like little rocks or little weights that can feel gravity being pushed or pulled, and it gives us a sense of where we are in space. Now, the main functions of the vestibular system are our gaze stability, our balance, our postural control, as well as our proprioception or our awareness where we are in space. And so there are some connections from the inner ear to multiple parts of the nervous system, the brainstem, the brain, cerebellum, as well as our eye muscles. And so that will affect, or dysfunctions in these areas will affect multiple different areas of the balance system, the visual system. So there's a lot of integration within our nervous system itself. So now that we get a bit of an understanding of the anatomy, why do we get dizzy? What can cause those problems? So we're here talking about the vestibular system, but of course there can be some other causes of dizziness. So as an example, the cardiovascular system, if there's been some sort of ischemic event, a heart attack, a stroke, something like that, where blood flow has been altered, you could have some dizziness associated with that. If there's been a neurological event, multiple sclerosis, stroke, these things can cause dizzy symptoms, lightheadedness, imbalance. Problems with the visual system. So if there's been a change in your prescription, if there's been a change due to a cataract, oftentimes we could see some visual vestibular type mismatches that cause dizziness or a change in perception can cause dizziness. there can be some underlying psychogenic causes, so stress, anxiety, panic attacks. We do see that these are overlaid in some cases with other medical conditions or as an association with the vestibular condition that can magnify or make worse some of the dizzy symptoms or can give people a sense of dizziness. And then finally, other medical conditions. So as an example, diabetes. There can be multiple complications. You could have visual changes with diabetes. You could have something like a peripheral neuropathy where your feet, you can't feel it quite as well, which can affect your balance, give you a sense of being off balance. Or even something like hypoglycemia or low blood sugar can give people a sense of dizziness, clamminess, that type of thing. And now many medications also have a side effect of dizziness. If you look at any medication and the side effects, one of the main ones that we do see is dizziness. So a lot of times as a vestibular therapist, we're trying to weed out what the cause of the dizziness is. Is it something vestibular, or could it be any other form of complicating factor? Now, when it does come to the vestibular system, we often will try and break the issue down into three or four main areas of concern. So first, is it a mechanical issue? So primarily looking at the otoconia or these little crystals in the inner ear and causing some sort of dysfunction within the mechanical dysfunction within the vestibular structure. So that's a very common one. Secondarily, could it be a peripheral nerve issue? So does someone have an injury to the vestibular nerve or the what they call the membranous labyrinth that makes up the vestibular system? Could it be a problem centrally with the brain or the nervous system? So we talked about some of the underlying issues that could be an issue there. And then in some cases, it can also potentially be a musculoskeletal issue around the neck. So there are instances of cervicogenic dizziness or neck-related dizziness. And that might be associated with some degenerative changes, or maybe someone was in a car accident. They have like a whiplash type disorder that is also causing some dizziness in certain positions or with some neck movement. So if we dive a little bit deeper into some of those areas, some of the more common vestibular disorders that we're treating. So first of all, the mechanical issues. The primary one is benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, or BPPV. And so what that is, that's a brief transient vertigo that's caused by the stimulation of the little sensory organ called the cupula by these crystals, which have made their way into the semicircular canal. So in each inner ear, there's three of these canals. One points forwards, one points sideways, and one points backwards. And most of the time, these crystals will end up in the posterior semicircular canal. And so when people look up or look down, or occasionally when they roll straight over in bed, is they can experience vertigo or kind of a spinning sensation. Now, secondary to that, they may also describe some nausea, vomiting, being off balance, lightheadedness. But typically this BPPV will last less than a minute. There are some variations of that, but for the most part, it's a very brief bout of vertigo. So what that often looks like in the clinic, we use what they call infrared goggles in a lot of cases to look at people's eyes. And when we lay a person down on the bed, as we see their eyes actually start to move about in a rotational type manner. And that is indicative of BPPV. So as an example, this is what the infrared goggles might look like. The therapist would lay the person down or maybe move their head in one direction, and it would cause the eye to actually start to beat side to side. So it gives the person a sensation that the world is spinning, when in fact their eyes are just twitching back and forth. And again, this like may last 10, 15, 20, maybe 30 seconds, typically less than a minute, and then goes away. So we'll talk a little bit more about what we do to treat that a bit later. Going next to the peripheral vestibular system, if there is something wrong with the nerve itself, a labyrinthitis or a neuritis, we might see something like this, where there is a swelling in the nerve or in the vestibular system itself, or maybe someone's had a concussion and caused a bit of trauma to that area, and there's been some associated swelling with this area. So that would be more of an inflammatory condition. There are things called perilymphatic fistulas or acoustic neuromas, and this is actually a growth inside the skull itself that actually will push on the auditory or vestibular nerve, section of the nerve, or potentially even a growth in the vestibular system itself. And so this compression would cause the nerve to health to be affected and could cause dizzy symptoms. And often we may even see some auditory symptoms as well, where people are, you know, having difficulty hearing. And then another common condition that we wanted to address, or that I wanted to address, was this idea of Meniere's disease. So it's a condition where there's a fluctuation of fluid within the inner ear. So Meniere's disease is also called endolymphatic hydrops. And this increase in pressure can cause pressure on the nerve itself or on the vestibular system and affect the functioning of the nerve. Now, with these peripheral conditions, we often see that a person can lose the function of their vestibular ocular reflex. And so we'll talk about that in a little bit, but essentially what we're looking at is the ability for a person to keep their eyes fixed on a target when they're moving their head about, and it can cause symptoms such as oscillopsia or double vision. And we could see hearing changes or ringing in the ears, like I mentioned, with acoustic neuroma or swelling in the inner ear. We may see vertigo, but typically it can last not just, you know, a minute or less, but actually for a few hours to a few days. We may see that their balance has been affected. They may get nausea, vomiting, could feel lightheaded, and also some neck or temporomandibular joint pain could also be a complicating factor. Now, centrally, if there is a problem with the vestibular system from a central position, so an issue with the brain or spinal cord or something of that nature would be a central cause. So primarily it would be things like a stroke or a transient ischemic attack. A head injury, so a concussion, quite commonly we see that in the clinic. Multiple sclerosis, because it's a demyelinating event where the covering around your nerves is being affected, it can cause problems where the peripheral nerves intersect with the brainstem. And then different areas of the brain, depending on where they're affected, could cause some symptoms. Now, people don't always complain of dizziness in these situations. A lot of times it might be a balance specific symptom. So they might feel like they're leaning sideways or that they're just really off balance. They may have a loss of sense of kind of where they are in space. So it really just depends on how complicated their injury is and what we're seeing on the assessment, how we would go about treating it. So if someone is having a vestibular issue, how do they go about getting it assessed and treated, and who can help them with that? So from a rehabilitation perspective, the primary ones that most people will have access to would be your physiotherapist, or occupational therapist in the community, as well as some audiologists that are working to help diagnose or clinically diagnose these conditions. A lot of the physicians that you'd be seeing in regards to these conditions, such as a neurologist, an otologist, which is a physician that deals with the ear, or a neuro-otologist that has a neuro background that looks at the ear, a neuro-ophthalmologist, which is a neurological physician that deals with visual difficulties as well, or a neurophysiologist that would actually do some testing on your vestibular system to determine and confirm how well that system is working from a physiological standpoint. But the physios, the audiologists, and the OTs are often working with these patients clinically to improve their functioning through vestibular rehabilitation. Now, one of the great resources that Balance and Dizziness Canada has is they actually have a listing of practitioners that have a background in vestibular rehabilitation on their website. And there's different levels of training that a lot of these professionals will have. And so depending on the nature of your condition, you can be accessing a clinician close to you. Now, some areas of Canada or even the US may have local provincial physiotherapy associations or state physiotherapy associations that do have some therapists listed on their websites. Just be mindful of looking into the training that your therapist may have, because oftentimes it can vary. Anything from a sort of a 1 day or 2 day course all the way up to a multi-day or week long certification program. So just be mindful of the background that they might have. And the same thing goes with some of the doctors and specialists that you might see. You may see an ear, nose, and throat doctor that isn't particularly comfortable with the vestibular system. So they may know a colleague that might. So just ask questions when you're seeking out treatment. So you do find someone that a vestibular therapist that you're comfortable with, what would the assessment look like? So usually you'll go through a fairly thorough vestibular history, lots of questions on when do you get dizzy, how long does it last, et cetera, et cetera. And because that will help to guide us as far as where we want to go with our treatment, and help to also guide the rest of the objective assessment that you might go through. Oftentimes, the therapist would also assess the neurological system, your neck, just kind of make sure that everything is safe and there's been nothing more concerning that could be going on that you need to be referred back to your doctor. And then also based on the history, we'd be looking at some of those main areas that I described before. So we're looking for a mechanical issue, a peripheral issue, or a central issue. So the types of questions that the therapist might ask, they might ask about, you know, your cardiac background, if there's been any heart issues, chest pain, numbness, things like that. If there's been any trauma, concussion, previous migraines, or previous vestibular issues. If you're having any pain, if you're having any neck pain, headaches, numbness, tingling, any of the kind of concerning neurological symptoms we want to rule out. And then if there's any, you know, background history of depression, anxiety, panic attacks, because we do know that those things can magnify symptoms, but also can affect a person's recovery from a vestibular condition. And a lot of times we're also interested in, you know, when did this start? Is this a new dizzy issue? Or is this something that you may have been dealing with for a number of months to a number of years? So it's not uncommon for people to go, you know, for a number of months or years getting diagnosed. I think the average is about 7 professionals before someone gets diagnosed for their vestibular condition. So the assessment and treatment of BPPV, so the mechanical assessment, what we're typically doing is going through some different positional tests. So one is called a Dix Hall Pike maneuver, and the other one is called a supine head roll test. And so what that would look like in this picture here, the therapist would be standing next to the patient and lay the person down on their back with their head tilting back slightly. And what we're trying to see is if that provokes the person to get their vertigo. And if that is the case, then what we would do is one of a few different maneuvers, depending on which canal the crystals are in. There's a maneuver called a modified Epley maneuver, another one called a horizontal canalith repositioning treatment, or also known as the barbecue roll. And so essentially what we're doing is we're gradually positioning the person's head around to determine which position, or floating those crystals back around to seat them back where they should be and fixing the situation. So usually it's a pretty quick fix, 1 to 2 treatments, and most people will be feeling much better. However, as I say to a lot of my patients, we can correct it, but we can't cure it. So there is a recurrence rate of about 25% within the first year and about 50% within 5 years. So, but it's benign, it's not harmful, but it is something that can recur from time to time. That's very easily managed. Now, peripheral vestibular assessments, what we're looking for is the ability for a person to A, maintain their balance, so if they're having any balance issues, but also if they're able to maintain their gaze and use their vestibular ocular reflex. So if you look at your screen right now and you pick a point on the screen and you turn your head left and right, if your eyes are able to stay clearly on one point, that would be an example of your VOR that is intact. So what we do is we do a test like that where we're looking at having the person look at our nose, and we would do a quick movement left or right with their head into just a small movement. It's nothing going to hurt the person or their neck or anything like that, but it does allow us to see if the eye is able to stay fixed in a target or not. If not, then that's something that we could work on in treatment. So treatment can vary depending on the severity of the injury, anywhere from 6 to 12 weeks on average that we may be working with someone, and often includes potentially doing some gaze stability exercises, or some balance exercises. And it's not uncommon for people to actually have multiple things going on at once. So they may have BPPV and they have an underlying vestibular neuritis or something that we have to also treat. And then finally, from a central perspective, if someone is dealing with a neurological condition where we think that there's some balance difficulties or dizziness issues, we would be looking at, for example, the ability for someone to follow a target around, so their eye control. We also look at their VOR and their balancing, doing some different balance tests just to see how well they're functioning. And then the treatment really is tailored to where they're having their difficulty. So if they're having difficulty with visual tracking, we get them to do visual tracking drills. If they're having difficulty with blurred vision when they move their head, we might get them doing activities practicing that. So it's really tailored to the individual patient. Now, typically these central vestibular patients can be slower to recover, and treatment can occur over the course of a number of months. So just to dive in a little bit more, like what might treatment actually look like for those people that are needing to do, ongoing vestibular rehab, a lot of time it comes down to exercise. Now, if we came across a patient that was having some balance difficulties, we may get them doing some balance exercises with a variety of different permutations or challenges to their balance, depending on how they're doing. So we may start with someone standing with their feet together and trying to maintain that position statically with their eyes open, then with their eyes closed. We may switch up their foot positioning so they're in a one-legged stand or a heel-to-toe type position. And we might even get them working on standing on an uneven surface, a piece of foam or a wobble board or something of that nature, or sitting on a Swiss ball, an exercise ball, and working on their balance that way. And then moving into maybe a more dynamic task, we get someone walking and doing some head turns while they're walking, or maybe they might be throwing a ball from one hand to the other back and forth. So it really depends on where the person's at and what they need to be progressing towards in their day-to-day life. Now, if someone was having difficulty with their vision and every time that they were moving their head, they're having some blurry type vision or difficulty keeping their eyes on a target, we would turn that into an exercise. So as an example here, the gentleman is, holding his arm out at, or his thumb out at arm's length, and he's basically looking at the target, moving his head back and forth. So they may start at a slow speed, nice and controlled, and gradually increase their speed over time. We may get the target to move a little bit. We might change up the background depending on where they're at. So there's a variety of kind of things that we could do. We could get the person up into standing or standing on a piece of balance equipment to make life a bit more challenging for them, with a goal of trying to make it so that day-to-day tasks are much more tolerable. And then finally, if they are having some sort of visual tracking or visual saccade type issues, a lot of times reading could be something that someone has some difficulty with. We might get them to do a task like this, where they would basically scan down this grid of letters. Starting at the top, they would look at the A, and then look at the S and the D, and then the F and the G, and kind of looking back and forth between the letters, back and forth as quickly as they can, in a succession of exercises, as an example. So these are a smattering of a few activities that a person may go through depending on what they're seeing. And again, the goal would be to, often bring on their symptoms a little bit, give them a chance to rest, and then repeat those tasks, with progressive stepwise increases in their activity to try and improve their overall functioning. So these are just some references for some of the prevalence studies that were noted earlier in the lecture, if anyone did want to check those out.